There's also something called scotopic sensitivity syndrome. And the reason I bring it up is it seems that every semester I run into a student that doesn't know they have scotopic sensitivity syndrome and it's had an impact on their performance in their courses. So scotopic sensitivity syndrome, we don't really know the exact cause of it. They understand that it has something to do with wavelengths of light that are not correctly interpreted in the visual pathway. So somewhere in that visual pathway from the eye to the brain, something happens with that wavelength of light. So it's not correctly interpreted. And people that have scotopic sensitivity syndrome see things differently. When some people read, this is what it looks like. The words are all blurry. Other people see this, okay, where they see, like they're seeing double. Other people see rivers. Some people see this, where the words look like seesaws. Others see shaky when they read. Some see a swirl. Some see a washout. The different ways or the different images that people perceive when they have scotopic sensitivity syndrome definitely differs. One of the things that people with scotopic sensitivity syndrome have in common is they have a decreased ability for depth perception. So, for example, if you go to walk onto an escalator, so you're at the mall and you go to get on an escalator, some people have with scotopic sensitivity syndrome have a real issue with the distance between their tip of their foot and the first step on the escalator. So you might see them kind of shuffling, right, to get on the escalator. At night, they may have a problem with depth perception between the car in front of them if they're driving. This is a condition, like I said, that some students don't know they have until they've taken this class. And I was one of those students. I didn't know that I had scotopic sensitivity syndrome until I was in college. And I had a professor that watched me fill in a Scantron at the end of an exam. And I wasn't filling out the Scantron question one, question two, question three consecutively. I was jumping around on my Scantron. And that professor happened to ask me why I fill in my Scantron that way. And I said, well, what are you talking about? And he said, well, why don't you go in consecutive order? You have all the answers written on your exam. Why not fill them in order? That would save you time. And I said, well, I am. And he said, no, you're not. So that's when I figured out that something was wrong. And so when we looked at my exam, answers on the exam versus what I bubbled in on the test were completely different. So then I was diagnosed with this. And treatment is pretty simple. Basically, you want to, I have glasses that have various colored filters that have been meshed together. And you, when you go to the eye doctor, they test you with the hundreds and hundreds of different colored filters. Pretty soon you find a combination that works for you where when you read, things look normal. Now, to me, I never knew that I had a problem because I just thought that that's how we all perceived. I know I didn't enjoy reading at the time. And growing up, I didn't enjoy reading. And now I know why. Now I really enjoy reading because I put my glasses on and the words actually stay on the page. For me, I have a wave. The words move up and down. So this is a type of learning disability. So I just wanted to share that with you because so many people are unfamiliar with it. And again, it is a type of dyslexia.